So we're starting with our third panel, I think, today. It's a keynote panel we entitled How Different National, Cultural and Institutional Contexts Frame Sexual Violence and Disclosure. And I think context has been already mentioned before and the importance of looking at the context. So I think it's going to be really interesting to have four different people from different places and cultural contexts talk about what was shaping their work in this project. All four of them are part of the project, are researchers and activists in our project. And we'll say we have Alexandra Savos here from Greece, from Pantheon University, Marta Luxan from the Basque Country University, Norma De Piccoli from UNITO in Italy, and Vanita Sundaram from the University of York. And that's the order in which they will speak now. Each of them will have 10 minutes, maybe 12 for those who have more difficulties expressing themselves in English, so be patient. And we're starting with Alexandra. You have the power, Alexandra.
So, hi again from me. So I will talk to you now a little bit about the project we did at Pantheon University. In a way, being the only institutional context in the project without a policy framework puts me in this privileged position of being the first to talk in the panels always. as I said, we reviewed university rules and regulations for all universities in Greece based on the information we could retrieve from their websites. And we also reviewed student services and care pathways, whether any of these exist. And that was our initial research into policies and practices at universities, at Greek universities. And we discovered that there are no official policies in university rule, in any university rules and regulations, nor are there services targeting sexual violence and supporting victims specifically. So some universities may have equality offices, newly established equality offices, but these equality offices do not have the mandate to also address issues of sexual violence. And some universities, not Pantheon, but other universities may have student psychological services, support services, but these support services do not, again, explicitly address issues of sexual violence or harassment. So if such cases do come to the psychologist's attention, we don't know, and neither do we know what kind of approach she takes and how she supports the victim. At Pantheon University specifically, the regulation of the university does not contain any reference to sexual or gender violence, and the university doesn't have a student psychological support service. So there is a significant lack in both policies and care pathways and services. Now, just to mention something that was brought up earlier as well, that there is legislation around sexual violence and harassment and gender-based violence that looks at the university, that recognizes the university as a workplace, but it doesn't address the university as an educational institution or a social context. Now, part of the reason for this lack of support services this more general lack for support services are funding issues. So it's very interesting that in the years between 2003 and 2008, the Fang Jian University was part of a group of Greek universities that got funding to implement gender studies programs. In the context of those gender studies programs, which were both undergraduate and postgraduate, some universities also established services for students and especially women students. In the context of which they also, they also brought up issues of sexual violence. That once that funding stopped, then the services as well as the gender studies programs were canceled, discontinued. So there is a link between funding and initiatives that can occur. Apart from that, we definitely know from our own position and experience in the university that it's an institutional culture, which, as the broader culture as well, is very much defined by heterosexism and power asymmetries, and both of these are normalized. So it's considered very normal if a male, professor flirts with a female student. This doesn't raise any eyebrows. The other thing that was of interest to us was that we found that older and younger generations of feminists do not necessarily meet and don't necessarily also share a common discourse. So that was something that we would need to explore further. If we want to look into how a kind of activism can develop on campus. So the training that we performed, we informed the university in general about the project, and then we sent out emails inviting people to sign up for the training. We decided that it was best to have the participation on a voluntary rather than mandatory basis because we wanted to, we didn't want to attract or to give occasion for more resistance than what we would be already expecting. What we found out was that this kind of official recruitment strategy was definitely not enough to mobilize participants, and we had to extensively mobilize personal networks, calling up people again and again, members of staff, members of teaching staff, members of admin staff, to invite them, to tell them to tell their friends. So I would say that it was largely this personal network mobilization that got the people to the training. Now, our training model was different from other contexts because we decided to have mixed cohorts. In other words, cohorts where students and admin staff and teaching staff participated together, usually between 10 and 12 participants. And we did that, first of all, because we expected that we wouldn't get enough staff to participate, and secondly, because we wanted, given that there are no policies or other protocols, we wanted to have students from each department, at least one member of staff or from the admin department, and students, so that they would have someone to refer to whom they would recognize as having been in the same training together. So that was our reasoning for choosing the mixed cohort way of doing it. We trained 80 people, 70 of them were women and 10 were men. And we received, 90% positive evaluations, which was very interesting given the initial resistance. And in, Yes. Closing, it has become clear to us, and this is something that we will take up in our kind of dissemination and legacy activities, that there needs to be a wider discussion among Greek universities. It's not a Pantheon issue, and it's not even a legislation issue. Greek universities, or representatives from Greek universities, have to sit together, discuss how they want to go forward with this, and then develop some kind of common strategy or manifesto, so that it will be a shared, so that a kind of shared mobilization and sensitivity and awareness around that can develop. It will never happen at the level of one university. In order for this to be successful and to, you know, take roots, it will have to be a collective endeavor. Right, okay, this is just some numbers. This will be on the website, so if anyone needs to contact, wants to contact us, you can find all our information there. Thank you very much.
So thank you, Alexandra. Now we open the mic for Marta from the University of the Basque Country.
Hello everyone, and thank you for being here with us in this important moment. I am a very good speaker in Basque, Spanish and Catalan, but not in English, so I am going to read my intervention. Sorry about it, but I think that it will be better for you. The title of the panel we are discussing right now asks how different national, cultural and institutional contexts frame sexual violence and discourse. And I am going to follow this question in order to provide some ideas that may be helpful for future intervention around sexual violence in the university. I am going to start from the national context, and allow me to specify here that I am speaking about the legal and administration level, meaning the state level, which in a nationally plural country like ours is not always necessarily parallel to the national context. In Spain, and therefore in the Basque Country, the 2004 law, provides a frame for anything related to gender and violence in the last decade or so. More precisely, the frame it provides is a gender-based violence one, hence the limitation of answering to all situations of sexual violence that we can face in campuses. For instance, the 2004 law is mainly focused on partner, ex-partner violence, and therefore leaves out many forms of violence that are actually present in our campuses. The University of the Basque Country had a protocol that was based in this text, and therefore is in the process of being revisited now to offer a wider view on the issue. It should include, in one hand, more forms of violence that women and other non-normative subjects go through, and in the other, a view that connects violence against women to homophobia and transphobia. We are yet to see if the new text and pathways will work in this direction. The 2004 law presents lots of measures that are not only punitive, as we heard this morning, and this is one of the main achievements of the legal text. However, during the last years, the preventive measures have been far less developed. In our context, this has derived in a very central position of the legal denouns in the university pathways around sexual violence. Legally reporting a case of sexual violence has been considered the starting point of any procedure, and this has proven wrong, given the fact that not everyone is in a position to report legally, and not everyone wants to. In addition, it implies a view that deepens the gap between what is considered sexual violence and what is not considered sexual violence. We hope to switch this tendency and start thinking about supporting survivors independently of reporting or not legally, and thinking social change strategies in campus that are not based in this sort of obligation, as Izaskun told us, explained this morning. Moreover, the particular situation of Spain and all its different levels of administration and regulation that make any intervention more complicated, finally, in university, yet another level of complexity. when trying to make use of punitive measures against perpetrators and protection measures for survivors, the universities find themselves in a clash between their obligation to protect all students and staff equally and the need to apply those measures. All those measures must find the agreement of all the parties involved and cannot be imposed until the legal process, if any, has undergone to the phase of resolution. I am going to name now a few contribution points in a cultural level. To start with, I would like to say that there are some common sense views in our context at the moment that we are facing, and I would say, and let me be an optimist on that, that are getting closer to overcome. The first of those views sustains the idea of violence derived from patriarchy is something from the past that has been already overcome. The second idea is that sexual violence comprises a series of violent expressions that are always physical and perpetrated by unknown subjects. This idea of the rapist around the corner, who is an unknown person, and this idea that produces victimization itself leaves aside lots of forms of violence that we are expecting and seeing. And it makes it difficult to go on with feminist claims around sexual violence. Most of the people who attend our training sessions did not share those ideas and were really eager to think and rethink mechanisms to tackle a form of violence that they considered very real and very multiply in its form of expression. This is good news. It means some people are beyond those common sense ideas that actually hide a backlash against feminists and queer activists. But at the same time, made us think about the fact that most people attending our voluntary, as in Greece, training are already quite interested and have given some thought about the matter and how to get to the others. There is a fifth idea, however, that many of the participants share with what we consider to be another dangerous common sense idea. This idea disconnects sexual violence from the structures that provide its very existence. We have found quite a lot of resistance against identifying power structures behind violence. Without talking black and white, we should be able to find some patterns, violence against women, transphobia, homophobia, that can help us take better the cases and not present them as a bad person does something to an innocent person and everything is relative and depends on their personality. Last but not least, as Ruth Lewis said this morning, in the last years we have observed an increasing interest in sexual violence and in the ways to confront it. Lots of campaigns have been designed and implemented, and a different conceptualization of sexual violence has started to emerge, opening a door for many different debates. All those debates, opened through hard work of feminist activists, are having a positive impact in projects like ours. In our case, it has been relatively easy to include our training in the official university training offer, or to place some issues in the first line when the rewriting of the protocol started. However, we are conscious that the social importance given to the sexual violence or its position in the feminist agenda does not necessarily imply openness of university institutions towards tackling the issue as we have seen too often. Finally, I am going to go through some consideration about our institutional context, hoping that they can be understood and eventually applied to other contexts. By institutional level, we mean our university. And we talk about five elements: campus life characteristics, because we don't have something like campus life in our university, so it's like people go to class, to lessons, and they are thinking about the university, not like a social place. The second one is the existence or not of a permanent structure for gender and sexuality issues. And for us, it has been a really important thing. We have a lot of support from the Equality Office. The third one, it would be the presence of associations and groups. And we think that it's very important to to look to these groups, and it's necessary to think about how is the structure of these groups, because they are a very fast groups. They reorganize every year, but we think that if we want to do something, we have to work with it, because with these groups. With this sort of groups. The fourth is the size of the dimension of the institution, and I only want to say that our university is a very big university, and it has some difficulties because this, but we have been working in a very little one, and it was difficult too, because it was so little. And it's very difficult to speak about your colleagues or to think that your colleagues are doing I don't know what when you are working in a very, very little space. And the finally element that I want to speak about is the existence or not about the protocol. I think that Barbara this morning has talked about this, but well, I want to say something because it's a very special situation with the protocol in our university. The existence or not existence of a certain protocol or regulation that set the base for programs or initiatives around sexual violence seems determinant, although in a complex way. In our case, as in many other universities, the protocol we had since 2011 acted more as a first formal step to tackle gender-based violence than as a base for establishing specific action besides initiatives for general awareness raising. Besides, the protocol was already valued insufficient and incomplete in terms of inclusion by the very Equality Office, and therefore left suspended to be revisited. That said, our training has centered not only about transmission about what can be done in case of sexual violence using the already existing tools, because they are practically not non-existent. Of course, we have provided information about resources inside and outside campus, but our main focus has been in thinking and rethinking intervention in a specific context. This has led us closer to at least two goals. Firstly, providing better information on what is going on and how staff members and students are perceiving it, in order to better provide resources in the future. Secondly, we have contributed to open a debate and speak up about sexual violence, but not as an issue that concerns survivors and perpetrators, but as something that the whole university community and the institution itself should be reflecting about. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Marta. Now we switch PowerPoints, I think, and we're going to have Norma from Unito University in Italy, and she's going to have... Oh, no, that's not the one. That's the one that works. Wait a second until it comes up.
Yes. Good afternoon, and I'm happy to be here, and sorry for my English. And I said this just waiting for the slide, because I have some data to show you. National and cultural, the name is National Cultural Institutional Context. I begin with the national context, because I think that Italy about sexual violence. No.
No. We should put a separate PowerPoint, the number 3, from Unito Italy.
Because if we can show the data about sexual violence in Italy, there is the problem, sure, but we are in line with the other European country. The problem, the specific problem in Italy, the specific problem in Italy, it is a culture that change, maybe difficult to change a culture based on the gender difference, because we are in patriarchal culture and where the male power is very big, is very strong, maybe as other Mediterranean country. Another difference between Italy and UK is as Spanish that we have not a campus. That is that the students follow lesson in the university, but they live in the city. So we have built for this project a very strong link with the town, because it is necessary that citizenship and students too know all the services that are present in the city, devoted to accept the problem of sexual violence. I begin to read so I can go fast. As I said, if we look at these data, are not so different from the other in European country. I think that it is interesting to show that a comparison of the results with the previous research conducted in 2006 shows that there is a difference according to sexual violence. Less severe forms of violence are declining, but women show a greater ability to get out of violent relationships due to an increased awareness of violence. Women report more the violence and talk more about it, and more victims see sexual violence as a crime. Thanks to Los Angeles affair, Hollywood affair, many women speak about. This is a positive question, but we must continue to work, we must continue to sensitize to this work. Mainly, we must continue to contribute that people consider violence also some subtle form of behavior, because a violence is a violence. It begins with a subtle form of behavior, and it becomes more and more violent. Sorry. In Italy, if data about rape are declining, a culture based on paternalism and machismo remains. For example, Italy is among the European countries with the worst gender equality indexes. And these are the very, very recent data that are sorted a few days ago. The focus on violence against women has grown together with its visibility in public discourse and more recently in the political debate. Notwithstanding the greater attention in the media, in public debate, in the central institution on gender violence, there is a wide discrepancy between the changing law on one side and the cultural representation of violence against women and social practices on the other side, especially in the private sphere. Even if some positive expectations can be reported, a large part of media, television, newspapers, etc., that report news about gender violence point attention on the victim's behavior and or describe the violence as a not controllable ratus. In many cases, the gender violence is in some way justified and not definitely condemned. Violence is a social question, it's not a private question. This is a very important thing that we must, and we must train the person in this thought. It can be in our context expression of a still existing patriarchal culture, and as someone describes, gender violence is an expression of male affirming power on women. I present some information about the law, because in Italy too the law, it seems interesting, but the law don't change attitude, the law don't change culture. Sexual violence in Italy was considered a crime against public decency and morality until 2 decades ago, because we are very, very in middle age. In 1996, establishing provisions against sexual violence turned the crime of sexual abuse into a crime against the person, introducing the crime of sexual violence. Since then, a series of amendments and new laws to contrast the phenomenon of violence have been enacted under the pressure of the civil society organizations. For instance, this law exacerbated the punishment of, for sexual acts and introduced stalking as a type of offense punishable in different way that I don't read, we can see in the slide. Quite recently, a new law has been approved to contrast the phenomenon of feminicide. In 2013, further, the law exacerbates the punishments and improves tools for victims' protection. Moreover, interesting legislative measures have been recently adopted at the regional level in Piedmont, to which the University of Turin belongs. This regional law, among other important novelties, intends to implement the national directives concerning the introduction of the so-called Pink Code for female victims of violence in order to offer them a protected assistance from a specialized task force composed by health and law enforcement professionals and expert advocates. In this slide, we can see that our university is a big university, so you can see the number of students, the number of teachers and researchers, and the number of administrative staff. In the University of Turin, it's paid attention to the topic of discrimination based on gender and oral sexual orientation, and to the topic of gender violence by some normative instruments, some services, and by some past and present initiatives. For example, at the moment in the University of Turin, there is no service specifically dedicated to gender violence, but there are some services that, in case of sexual violence, can intervene and or offer support. For example, the Guarantee Committee for Equal Opportunity promotes a culture of equality and operates against any form of discrimination under the University Code of Conduct. Then, la consigliera di fiducia, that is confidential counselor, provides information, advice, and assistance free of charge to university personnel and students suffering from discrimination, harassment, infringements to their dignity or bullying. She because now is a woman, she does not belong to the university personnel and is therefore independent and impartial. Then I remember also the counseling service that is not specific for sexual violence, but it offers a service for all students need it. And I would like just to remember that thanks to this project, we reinforce the connection with the town, because there are important services in the Turin area. The city and provincial coordination against violence on women. It provides expertise and health, psychological, legal, public policy, cultural, social welfare, and educational services in order to protect the fundamental rights of women and to offer them support, countering gender violence, and promoting a culture of respect, reciprocity, and equality between women and men. I just remember this event that it is new for University of Turin, but it's new for university in Italy. That is the first course titled History of Homosexuality. That is the first course that has this title. This course will be held at the University of Turin, and we think that these show that the institution pay attention to guarantee equal opportunities and is sensitive to develop a thought that creates inclusion. Okay, so I go fast. If something interesting to know more, ask me then. University of Turin shows attention to the matter and offers to employees and to students institutional services to manage cases of gender or sexual-based discrimination and harassment. In spite of this, both norms and services for these matters seem not so known, and moreover, awareness of the topics is not very spread, as our data that Mara presented this morning show.
What?
What challenges? To maintain a constant vigilance within the institution to avoid a culture that tends to underestimate it, or not to see cases of subtle violence in study in workplaces, justifying stereotypes and attitudes. It is a problem, it is a question. The future, thanks to our project, it is planned to establish a coordination between the various existing resources in order to improve the knowledge of existing services among all the social actors of the university, create a network between the different services within the university so to answer the question related to violence and discrimination, and develop periodic training pathways in order to maintain a high sensitivity on these issues. Just to finish, I thank the project because this project help our institution to do something concrete, to try to change the culture beginning from university, but we hope that beginning from university we can create a contamination for our citizenship. Thank you.
So last but not least, all this Vanitas Ungaram from the University of York.
I feel I should apologize for not presenting a Basque or Italian. I'm only going to be speaking in English, folks. So I guess the English or the UK context is the one that most people here will be most familiar with, and we've touched on it a bit already this morning in terms of research and policy. So what I'm going to do is provide a short-ish overview of some of the research context and then also policy before moving on to talk more specifically about the York local context and how that's informed the training that we've developed and delivered there. So before I start, Pam often her thanks to people in absentia this morning, but I'd just like to reiterate my thanks to Mary Covet-Ondiek, who was the researcher on the project at the very start of the project and who development training. And then I'd also like to thank Anna Stead, who is current researcher on the project and who has had many different roles on the project, including being a facilitator and now the researcher and kind of been leading on the analysis and evaluation of that training as well for the project. So, as we kind of mentioned a few times earlier today, there's relatively little research in the UK around sexual harassment, violence in higher education specifically. There are some key kind of landmark research studies, many of which have kind of been commissioned by or conducted by the National Union of Students in the UK. So the Hidden Mark study in 2010 was kind of the first survey of that kind, and the women students experience of sexual harassment and violence in universities. Subsequently, the NUS conducted a LAD for culture and sexism survey in 2014, which included male respondents as well as men respondents as well as women respondents. And then they also collaborated, so the women's office at the National Union of Students led on a LAD culture audit as well in 2015. And some of the, so those studies taken together kind of established the fact that sexual harassment and violence in UK universities is prevalent, that many women students report experiences of harassment and violence not only in social spaces off campus but on university campuses, in university buildings as well. And so for example, 1 in 7 women in the Hidden Marks survey reported having experienced serious physical or sexual assault. And in the LAD culture and sexism survey, 2/3 of students said they witnessed another student experiencing sexual harassment or violence towards them. Obviously, Alison Phipps and Isabel Young led on the kind of really landmark, that's what she said, report, which was commissioned by the NUS. And that report was really pivotal in kind of bringing to the fore this term LAD culture as a term which would be used to describe almost as a proxy for sexual harassment and violence in the United Kingdom. And those of us working in this area are obviously problematizing this term and are very aware of its limitations in many senses. But actually what that study did and what that report enabled us to do was to have a really much more active national conversation about these issues than we had had previously. Myself and Carolyn Jackson, who's a professor at Lancaster University, also conducted the first case study on staff experiences of lad culture and perspectives on lad culture to try and understand better institutional perspectives on lad culture. With the thinking that if we're wanting universities to take responsibility for leading on culture change, we need to understand how people in universities, working in universities, understand these issues. So in terms of the national policy context, as again you've mentioned this morning, the policy context is increasingly supportive of research in this area, and that was mainly following, thanks to some of this research that I mentioned, following it led to the establishment of the University's UK Task Force on Violence Against Women, Harassment and Hate Crime in Universities in 2015. And following that, the Higher Education Funding Council for England announced two rounds of funding, Catalyst Fund, which was funded specifically to support action and oriented projects on sexual violence and harassment, online harassment and hate crime. And then, as was mentioned before, Emma Chapman, the 1732 group, was here, I'm not sure she's still here, but she did speak earlier on in the morning. 1752 group are a national lobbying and consultancy organisation whose kind of specialist expertise is around staff student misconduct in universities, and their work has been really important to bringing to light the prevalence of staff student misconduct and staff student misconduct as a specific area of sexual harassment and violence that we should be looking at in higher education. So moving the focus away from solely looking at student or student harassment and violence to seeing how universities are complicit in reproducing this in more ways than one. So in terms of the local context, the University of York, there hasn't been much kind of pre-existing work around the prevalence of sexual harassment and violence at the university, but one of our welfare offices, the Student Union Welfare Offices, did conduct a survey in 2013 looking at the prevalence of sexual harassment at the university, and they found that 72% of students reported sexual harassment while at the University of York. More recently, the York Student Think Tank conducted a survey where they found that 52% of students and 31% of staff had experienced sexual harassment on and off campus. The City of York Council has just very recently conducted a student health needs assessment and found that 10% of University of York students who were surveyed had experienced sexual assault. So there is a sense in which there's an emerging or growing evidence base that this is an issue for us to be paying attention to, for us to be responding to at the University of York specifically. And so now the university hasn't had a centralized system for receiving and collating disclosures of any kind, and as well as in relation to sexual harassment and violence, nor have we had a centralized reporting system. Our focus in this project has primarily been on disclosures, and I'll say something about what happened since we started on this project in that regard. There is a student counselling service on campus that does receive disclosures, but again, they're recorded. That is not something that is necessarily shared more centrally for us to be able to establish prevalence through that kind of data. And very recently, University appointed a staff member in a role which was called the Assistant Registrar for Promoting Community Cohesion and Respect. And that that person in that role is responsible for kind of improving our policies around sexual violence and harassment. And I think that it's no kind of coincidence that that's really dovetailed with our participation in this project. So we conducted three training interviews ahead of the development training, where we established these kind of three main things. One, which is with staff at the university. One, so there's a fairly prevalent perception, despite what I said about the existing service, that sexual harassment and violence aren't significant problems at York or in higher education generally. There's a sense that what constitutes sexual harassment isn't consistently understood by staff or accurately understood necessarily. So it's very often minimized, trivialized, instances of sexual harassment are dismissed as being things other than harassment. And there are misunderstandings that exist around sexual harassment in turn influence perceptions of institutional responsibility and accountability in relation to those practices and impacts of survivors. So just kind of a bullet point outline of the objectives of our training, which was directly informed by existing research in the area as well as our pre-training interviews. We wanted to ensure that our participants were engaging with theory around the causes of sexual violence and its complexities, the varying forms of sexual violence and manifest in, related sexual violence more widely to cultural and social norms, and thinking about why some student groups might be more vulnerable, so LGBTQI students, for example, understanding the impact of sexual violence on survivors and different ways in which disclosures might occur, so kind of trying to tackle some of the myths around how survivors look or present when they're disclosing. And then we wanted to kind of develop some, I suppose, softer skills around active listening, responding to disclosures in an empathetic and supportive way, and enabling our participants to signpost accurately to sources of support at the university and the local community. So in terms of training delivery, that was delivered by experts in the counselling service as well as experts in the field of gender and sexuality or sexual violence. We maximise sustainability by delivering the training through people who are permanent staff at the institution, so these counsellors as well as senior managers in different sections who were cascading trained to their own staff. Thus far we've delivered training to support staff across the university. And the way we decided to do that was that managers in each department were selected through a consultative process, and they in turn could decide whether or not they wanted that training to be compulsory or voluntary for their staff, and that differed across sections. Of course, we provided clear advance explanations and explanations on the day to participants that they were free to withdraw from any aspect of the training at any point during those sessions. So we conducted an evaluation of the training, which is to some extent ongoing. We found that the training had resulted in significant changes to participants' understanding and knowledge of sexual violence. It has also improved their knowledge about what constitutes sexual violence, what some of the prevailing myths around sexual violence are, and how to identify what sexual violence looks like, how it might present or manifest. And crucially, an understanding of the different ways in which survivors might respond and how to support survivors. And we found that that had increased, participants were reporting that their confidence in those areas had increased. So just in summary, to kind of highlight some of the institutional changes that have been made, and again, I'd like to echo Norma's comments about, in terms of thanks for kind of involving us in this project, because I think just simply being involved in the project has led to, kind of had a ripple effect and led to a whole range of institutional changes and kind of catalyzed a lot more activity around this at the university. So as a result of the training, some of the actions that have kind of sprouted, emerged from it, have been things like a revised university sexual harassment and violence policy, which didn't really exist explicitly before. We've now developed an online reporting system for students. There are clear consent and sexual violence web pages, and we also, through another project which directly builds on this, on the USV React project, begun to deliver this kind of training to student leaders at our university so that they can cascade that to students within who they're working with as part of their role as welfare staff or support staff. And so that includes consent and respect as well as some elements of bystander intervention. So I guess what we're thinking about now is how to roll this out to academic departments. As you might imagine, academics have been quite resistant to engaging in this kind of training. We have produced some flyers, which are somewhere in the room. I was going to have one to wave, but I don't know that yet. For anyone to have a look at, which is the way that we, for now, decided to try and kind of get our message across campus to tutors, supervisors, administrative staff working in departments. And I guess I'm really interested, just building on what Ruth said earlier this morning, about whether this is simply something that the university can continues to present itself as complying with University of UK's guidance, or whether it will go beyond that. And actually, personally, I think the fact that we've now involved students in changing the culture, transforming the culture, is what might be a driver for pushing us forward in a kind of positive, sustainable direction.
Thanks. So, time. It's nice energy we have. We have about 10 minutes that we could maybe expand to 11. So it's up to you to make some questions, suggestions, ideas, and I think someone is going to be passing the microphone so that everyone can listen better.
I was really interested in that last comment that you made, Anita. I was really interested in everything that everyone said, but particularly a comment that Anita just said about how the intervention has worked as a bit of a catalyst, because that's exactly what we're finding, what I'm finding at my university. That having, it feels as if we've been kind of banging on this door for years, and now we've got the programme, thanks to you, Anita, we've got something to actually get the university working on, and there are a few sort of spin-offs coming from it. And it makes me wonder how we can record that, because that's part of the cultural change that we're talking about. And it's just a suggestion that, to throw out there that we think about how we record not just the kind of formal research evaluation results of interventions, but the spin-offs that are catalysed by these kinds of interventions as well.
Yes, I agree. I mean, there is a strand of the project that's about the legacy of the project, and part of the legacy of the project is the fact that it's been able to catalyse these further actions. I mean, I kind of feel a bit conflicted because I think, I think formalisation of these practices, so for example, the online reporting or the, embedding different types of, not training, education, I use that word so much, I know. I think in a way that's when it becomes part of the institutional habitus in a way to do these things is when it maybe starts to change the culture. But I think, we found similar, I don't know whether other universities have found that it's kind of catalyzed other things, but I think to me that's really part of the legacy of the project.
You have how to evaluate a cultural change, if I understood.
Or how to record the other changes that are coming about, not just a more formal intervention.
How to record? For example, during after the
training, many local institutions ask us to organize a public conference on this topic. I don't know if this means a cultural change. Sure, it means that maybe the services existing in the city, in the university, could be more connected. This is the first step, and I can say that this is a concrete step. If a more connection between institution, academic, and the city, if this means a cultural change, we can know. I can record a feeling that more institution, formal and informal, ask to us to speak of this. Some school organize more and more education with young people with this topic. It is difficult to affirm that this change is thanks to our project. We are in a period in which something this morning said the same thing, maybe the Spanish colleague. We are in a period in which some movement exists. So I think that our responsibility is don't stop this movement, but to create situation to let run this movement in one direction.
Uh,
Yes, one idea or example from Pantheon is that we will be holding, in conjunction with the final conference, the local final conference, a stakeholders meeting, and we're inviting to the stakeholders meeting representatives from the 5 or 6 largest Greek universities. Also, universities that have, where incidents have occurred and which have been publicized. So there will be a discussion amongst us. This will be a first discussion. This for sure creates, opens something in the Greek context. In the sense that these people have not sat together before on this specific topic. And so, given that, yes, the momentum seems to be, the wider momentum seems to be in this direction, this specific action is I think, a kind of measurable outcome.
Yes, a couple of minutes more. There is a question there, Gigi, and there is a question here. I don't know who went first.
I think she would, okay, if that's all right.
Good that you know.
Thank you. I'm from the University of Surrey. I just wondered, actually, if you received any resistance from York University, for example, in doing the study and then producing statistics. So essentially, you know, maybe if the media gets hold of it, so many students experience sexual harassment in York University, almost as an adverse, statistic that can be used out there against you, so that we're going to kind of put you off doing your good work.
Thank you for that question. I'd say in relation to developing and delivering the training, there's not been any overt resistance. Probably there's been more explicit support, but I think there is resistance, and you see that in the more subtle ways. That's where I sometimes do think, to what extent can this kind of training in isolation bring about cultural change? Because what we're talking about is exactly what Alison pointed out this morning, that universities are gendered regimes, class regimes, race regimes, and so that infiltrates the distribution of power, the distribution of labor, distribution of emotions, all of that kind of stuff in those organizations. So there has been sort of more implicit form of resistance in relation to the training. In terms of statistics, our training didn't involve a student-facing survey, so we weren't ourselves producing any statistics about the percentage of students who experienced sexual harassment. But I know, and Alice can probably speak to this, when we delivered the training, we were talking, presenting statistics about the prevalence of sexual harassment in higher education. There was resistance expressed by participants. People expressed the view that it was maybe an inflated figure, or that lots of reports around sexual harassment violence might be false allegations. There were kind of views like that expressed in the training. The university itself, I wouldn't say they've been jumping out of their seats to publicize the work. And I think myself and Carolyn found in another project that we were doing on Black culture and higher education, it became really evident the reputational risk that's associated, or perceived reputational risk that's associated with for universities with participating in this kind of research. So, I mean, I've been kind of mooting the point that actually universities should maybe be talking about this in its recruitment activity, at open days and visit days, talking about what kind of an environment we're trying to create for students, in terms of being a safe space for survivors. And as I say, people are jumping up a bit for that. So I think it's not so much of an overt resistance as a more subtle form of it. Lack of action. Happy for us to do some work, but maybe not so much.
Hi, I'm from Brook, but I'm actually thinking more about my context of going to university myself. And we had quite a lot of European or like international students, so from Spain, France, and I feel like talking about culture, especially say a British context, is the culture of the university, and there was a lot about the lad culture coming up then, and our student president was trying to work on that, but it made it seem like it was a white British male problem rather than a community at the university. So more, I guess, maybe to the international people, how do we then see it as a culture with everyone involved? And maybe the cross-cultural understandings of people, say from different European perspectives, in one particular culture, how do we combat those cross-cultural, I guess, understandings of sexual violence and patriarchy and all these other things that you find?
The question is that, that in, students in Italy are mainly Italian. We are not an international framework. It's sure that we must see this question because our culture is more and more mixed, but concretely, now we have not this situation. Sure that from a theoretical point of view, as Barbara maybe showed this morning, the question gender is mixed with other cultural question because the model is the male, white, strong, and beauty, and so on. So the question that we are beginning to think also in Turin is that how similar or different sexual violence in the against the female has the roots in the same thought that don't accept other form of sexuality, other form of body, because it is homophobia, transphobia, are all form of violence that don't respect the body of the other, male, female, or whatever he, she wants. And this is a very actual problem. I don't know if you have given an answer to your comments, but out of topic.
So I don't know if I'm going to answer your question either, but obviously each of us, each of the partners developed contextually specific training which took into account kind of some of the things that people were talking about, so how not only the kind of legislative and policy context, but how sexual harassment and violence might be culturally understood or perceived. So I'm not really sure on things, but I mean, I kind of think, well, the abuse of power and kind of power differentials underlie sexual harassment and violence across contexts, so we've kind of been universally found on that one. But I think your issue, I think your question about kind of, is this just a white male phenomenon and how do we understand and address, respond to this across different contexts? I mean, I think that's quite interesting to think about even in the UK across different types of higher education institutions, you know, what are those that are campus-based versus those that are not, like, what kind of cultures do they produce and sustain? Similarly, the different student demographics, where there might be a higher proportion of mature or immature students or students who kind of taken a non-traditional route into higher education, how might the campus culture there feel and look like compared with somewhere that's more traditional? So I think those are definitely issues to think about within a national context as well as across contexts. Interestingly, and it's anecdotal, but I was at another university giving a talk about this life culture research some time ago, and that university was very, very different to York, which you might know is quite middle class and quite white and homogenous, really, in all the ways. And then the person that I was speaking to over there said, actually, it's interesting because a lot of the facts that I've been talking about in relation to alcohol consumption and social activity and that kind of stuff that's taking place on the campus and didn't apply at all because they had much greater student diversity in terms of ethnicity and faith background at that institution, but still they were seeing the same practices around sexual harassment and violence coming out. So, you know, that, I thought that was quite interesting that despite those differences in terms of some of the key indicators of life culture or whatever, they were still seeing
similar practices around harassment and violence. I'm very sorry that I didn't answer your question.
Okay, so 3:07, already late. Workshops will start after coffee break now. We said 3:15. Well, thank you to everyone for your presentations, your ideas. Thank you to everyone for